Hello, everybody. Actually, it's nice to be back to the department, and I'm happy to see you all here. And thank you very much for joining us today. Why is that? Okay. There are three most respected architects in Japan who contributed to establishment of architectural culture there. Miscikowski, Suzaki, and Hiroshi. It is our great honor to have him part of our faculty for this fall. And actually, thanks that he seems enjoying being part of ruins and having, I think, good time on our campus. Not only as an architect, but also he had been, he is well-respected educator. He actually taught many students and young architects at the Tokyo University, where he was a professor for 24 years. Tonight, actually, and also tomorrow night, we have an additional privilege to have seven of his old best students. And of course now, all of them are very established architects in Japan and who are representing each generation of Japanese architecture. And thank you to actually Professor Hara that we can have a kind of a sip of what's going on in Japan from them. And I'm so glad that all of them is here and to share this kind of interesting moment that we are going through in a special occasion so that the Hara School, Hara School, who are actually very important, I would say the line of architects creating foundation of the Japanese architecture, and they are celebrating this kind of reunion here in UCLA. Professor Hara set the theme of the actually the talk today, between East and West. He told me that the Japan is east of New York, but LA is west of Japan. Once you move the location you stand, the relationship between West and East can be easily flipped. So he thinks that it will be interesting to think about its new definition by standing on the Pacific Ocean. So hopefully we can hear sort of a different perspective around this kind of a between West and East concept tonight. Before I introduce three presenters today, I'd like to actually mention about Kazuhiro Kojima. He was one of the best students of Professor Hara and recently deceased because of the cancer. Actually, he was also a good friend of mine as well. He was born 1958 in Osaka, and he co-established Chilakan's architect 1986. And he was a partner of C&A Tokyo partner architect, and also he professor at the Yokohama Graduate School of Architecture, known as YGSA. I think the Japanese architecture world lost very important piece that could really create an exciting future. And I, to be honest, I always talk to him whenever I go back to Japan to just get the sense of what's going on and what we should do to make the better architectural scene in Japan. And I'm so sad that he's no longer here with us. Please give a actually a little moment of silence for him with me. Thank you. So our first presenter is Hiroshi Uta. He's an architect, and of course he went to University of Tokyo, and he's born in actually Tokyo as well. Since 2000, he is a chief architect in Neuob Inc. And also, he's a co-representative of Tokyo Picnic Club that he will mention in his own lecture today. Also, our second speaker is Kyoshi Takeyama, who is a professor of architecture at the Kyoto University, and he's a principal of AMORPHE, Takeyama and Associate, and chairman of the Architectural Design Association of Nippon. He received his undergraduate degree from Kyoto University and his doctorate degree from the University of Tokyo. He pursues poetical imagination in architecture through the theme of incomplete object, trans-territory, discontinuous city, and counterpoint of sky and earth. In 1991, he was awarded the Andrea Palladio International Architecture Prize. He was also production designer for film Kamataki by Canadian director Claude Gagnon, who won 5 hours at the Montreal World Film Festival 2005. And our last speaker is Nadim Karam. He is a multidisciplinary Lebanese who fuses his artistic output, sculpture,
and drawing with his background in architecture to create a large-scale urban art project in different cities of the world. He uses his vocabulary of forms in urban setting to narrate the stories and collective memory with a very particular use of that often absurdist approach, seeking to create moments of dreams in different cities of the world. And even he's from Lebanon, he said it's okay to call him Japanese. So without further ado, actually please welcome our first speaker.
And the Hiroshi is a very popular name, so Hiroshi, as they say. We are Hiroshi here, and I call Hiroshi Horibata second, so I will be Hiroshi the third. Okay. And today I'm going to introduce my artist work. And so because the time could be 20 minutes for each, so then these are my works, and then I'm doing the work from the dorm, the residential project to the urban project. And these days, especially for these 15 years, I've been into the urbanism. And this is the Tokyo Picnic Club that Aksan has mentioned. I am fanatic about picnic and studying the history of picnic, which started 200 years ago, and they are doing the installation. And this is the Newcastle and Gatehead in England. So I've cut the grass out as a shape of the airplane and bring the gross grass to the riverside. And I invite the all of the citizens to have a picnic. So the picnic is one of my it's a hobby to me, but these people always regard me as some professional picnickers, but I'm not. And this is another my art project called Popular Scape, and as time is limited, I want to show you some the movie quickly. This is a presentation of the world population, and the one story of the building is 100,000 people. So a million city will be 10 stories, and 100 skyscraper will be 10 million city. So Tokyo will be here, and Seoul, and Beijing, and Shanghai. So this is Asia. And this is Europe. And you can see the movie in this URL, in Vimeo. So if you are interested in, please have a look at it. And this is Frankfurt in Germany. And you can see the Berlin, and you can see all of Europe. And this is a visualization of the airports in Europe, and how the cities are connected. And two rings represent Paris, and three rings are London. So London is a hub of the transportation. And this is Africa. And the virtual airplane comes down to the African continent and comes to Pretoria and Johannesburg and going to the Cape Town on the tip. And this is Latin America. You see Buenos Aires and São Paulo, Rio de Janeiro. And I put the moon here for, and here we are. This is Western Coast and San Diego, Los Angeles, and San Francisco. And there are a lot of visualization, and this blue line represents the backbones of internet. So internet starts from the west coast and goes to the whole world. And you see the Chicago, Toronto, and New York. So I'm outside my career as an architect. I'm doing the research, I'm doing small projects, and the base of my the base of mine could be something about the city. Because the city is to me is a okay, the city to me is a place of where people, all of the people live together, and the city is a kind of masterpiece of humankind. So I love to visit the city, and I love to study about the city, and of course I love to do something or create something for the city. So then, my main part of this presentation is about my recent work in Tohoku area, and how the especially small cities in Japan is facing the very severe conditions. And my introduction is about the city of Yabuki in Tohoku area in the Fukushima prefecture. And this is Tokyo. Yeah, Tokyo is here, and this is Tokyo. And there used to be a highway called Oshu-Kaido, and now Shinkansen bullet train is going parallel to this road. And Yabuki is here. And this is Sendai, where I met Abe-sensei. And this is that new Korea plant, which is now under operation of the recovery. And Yabuki is here. And because the distance is not so close, so the city didn't suffer a severe affection of the nuclear plant. So the people here are living safely. Okay, the town has 7,400 population, and it used to be like this. And this is the old highway, Oshu-Kaido, and my site is here. And this is what the townscape used to be. This is almost 100 years ago. And all of the buildings are made of wood. This is 80 years ago. And this is 1950. And this is 1965. And this is 1990, and so on. And this is just before the earthquake, it's 2010. And obviously, it is degrading. Obviously, there's the unmaintained buildings along the street. So this is an aerial image of the city. And 70 years ago, the only road was this historical Oshu highway. And a lot of the houses and shops are situated along this highway. And after the World War II, the new national road was constructed here. And this is 30 years ago. This is a national road, and you can see the whole of the town facing started to sprawl to the countryside. And there were the relocation of towns there. So city expanded and expanded. And this is 3 years ago. And along the National Road, there are many roadside shops constructed. And the shopping mall has constructed here. So the historical highway is not used so frequently. So this is a diagram. So this is the highway, historical city. Highway and city center, and there's a sprawl here, and this is a new shopping area. And why this happened? The master plan of 20 years ago had encouraged to do the sprawl because the expectation was population will grow from 90,000 to 27,000 people. So then they encourage the development of this site. And especially the city had limited the use of this area to the commercial use because they thought that commercial area can grow. But the fact is the growth never happened. And the population decreased to 7,400 people. And because of this shopping area, the percentage of this area is 10% of the whole consumption of the city. But this is more important. Japan is losing the population. So this is a Japanese population shrinkage. And you see the master plan was made in this age,
and the people never have thought of the decrease. The Japanese people had began to thought about this shrinkage after 1997, when this research center and IPSSR had made a report that Japan will be shrink in the future. So then, after that, warnings people had began to think of it. And now we are realizing that is true. So here we are, and the new master plan is needed for how to manage the shrinkage in the city. So that was the situation of the Yamachiri. And the Tohoku Great Earthquake in 2011 had more enhanced this degradation. And because the city, the ground was very weak, so they recorded the highest rate of building wrecks where tsunami didn't come. And 30% of housing in town, totally 1,800 houses were damaged. And so then, because I was belonging to the University of Tokyo until last year, the city had contacted us to make the new master plan. So then I had participated in this project as a some consultancy of innovation planning. And this is after the big earthquake. This is the Oshu highway, and there were a lot of withdrawal of land owner, and there are a lot of vacant road. Okay, so this is reimagining the city center. And I did a lot of workshops there, four workshops, I think, and for the discussion. And I made the new urban structure to concentrate the new construction, especially for housing in the city center. And this is how we allocate the site for the recovery social housing who lost their houses by the earthquake. So this is allocation plan. And we, the city had decided to use this site as a the site for the recovery housing site. This is a street, and this is the recovery master plan that I have made. And these are the groups of the recovery housing. And the three other architects had designed these housings, and these, and I designed this community center for this district. This is a lighting plan, this is a landscape plan of the pavement, and this is the signage system plan. And about the architecture, I decided to utilize the wood because the wood is very flexible and very adaptable and very practical for making the townscape. You can design the house or you can design the shops, and at the same time you can use the wood for the parkings and for the fences. So wood can be everywhere. And wood is very friendly material. So this is the image of downtown Tokyo. And the wood always have the atmosphere for inviting people. So this is my first sketch. And this is the first sketch plan. And this is the concept of how I lay out the rooms. I've decided to have 10 rooms with squared roofs, and this is for, how can I say, festival parade. And I decided to have the kitchen called Much Kitchen, which means the town kitchen. And because if this kitchen is used in daily use, that will be very helpful when in the emergency case. People can work together and people can help together here. So this is the kitchen. And this is the plan with 10 squares. And the kitchen is in the center of the plan. And what is good in this plan is that you can use in many combinations. I mean, for the daily use, you use kitchen and you use this lobbies and you use this room. And for the dance club practice, you can use this and this and this and square and this larger room. And for the historical festival preparation, you can use all of these, the room facing to the Oshu highway. And this is the section, and this is about construction. I tried to work on Sherpensky truss, which I took from this very famous fractal shapes by the mathematical Sherpensky. And yeah, this is the base unit, and with 5 units of the base units, you can have the larger units, and 5 of these will make the much larger truss system. So this is the truss system I started. Okay, so from here I'll show some photographs. These two buildings are not designed by me. This is designed by another architect, and we had a discussion to have the same outlook. So the colorings and the metal, the roofs are in the same color. So this is my one, and you can look through, to the backyard court. And this is the daily use room facing to the highway, the old highway. This is another entrance. This is the combination of the other buildings. This is the facade. And this is the entrance in the center. And this is the kitchen. And this is the Japanese room we call tatami room, washitsu. And this is a truss, and this pattern is used for in the older community hall. So then I borrowed the design, and the people were very glad about having the same design on this paper screen. This is the larger room. And this is the backyard garden, this is grass. And I recommend the people to do the picnic there. And this is the tatami room again. Like that. Yeah, this is the Oshu highway. And this is the landscape. Then with red lanterns. Japanese always think of drinking sake when you see the red lantern. This is a symbol for the izakaya and the sake party. So I tried to have this. This is, you know, the made by the public fund, especially for the recovery from the earthquake process. And the city people, people in the municipality said that we cannot have this kind of signs in the public funded buildings, but I persuaded this is very important for the community cohesion, so that I won for this. Yeah, this is So this is the end of my presentation, and I quickly show how I did for the recovery process of the Tohoku great earthquake. And one of my conclusions is that to have a room, have a space that people can be together, and especially drink together and dine together. And that will reinforce, because I thought that will reinforce the force of the community. And the second thing is that as an architectural manner, I thought of having a lot of relationship with the outside, especially for the relationship with the street, could be very important, because this is a degraded city, a degraded street, and a lot of buildings are closing their doors and windows to the street. So I wanted more direct connection to the street. So then this is one of my ideas, to have this terrace and to have very small squares to attach to the street. So this is the end of my presentation. Thanks for
good evening. My name is Kyoshi Sei Takeyama. And Takeyama is the last name. And Kyoshi, my professor Hiroshi, I'm the first presenter Hiroshi. Hiroshi is popular, and Kyoshi is also very popular. But my name, and every Japanese have their own Chinese character name, and my Chinese character. And the name of Chinese character of my given name a bit different and very difficult to pronounce. And Sei is another pronunciation. And most of my colleagues and friends call me Sei. So I add my middle name. And I was advised by Tom May. The spelling is not I, but Y. Yeah, okay. And so. No problem. But the poster says the family name and given name is opposite, and say use the eyes. And I'd like to talk about my projects. And but first, I like to say today is very great occasion to see my professor Hiroshi Hara in UCLA with many ex-students. And most of the architects who were invited here have never worked for any other architects or a big firm. Worked for a big firm. Most of them, everyone, I think, started their career as architect from the beginning. And it's like Hiroshi Hara. And most of them are teaching at university. It also something. So most of the Hiroshi Hara School architects wants to be like Hiroshi Hara, wants to live like Hiroshi Hara. He is embodied the thing. And Eros and Logos is my title. And architecture is made of dead materials and never move, basically. But I like to overlay some sense of vital life And Eros, in this case, I used after the usage of Dr. Sigmund Freud. And he uses the term of Eros as a vital power of life. And it's my drawing when I was a student, I draw it. And so it overlay of the architectural objects and vital life. It's also. And this is drawing for this building. It was completed in 1991 and it's located in Tokyo. And another thing I'd like to talk to you is emptiness. I have pursued a sense of emptiness of space or a place belonging to nowhere. And I think this is one of the essential notion of the East, or according to Hiroshi's message, the West, because Tokyo is located to the west from LA. And this is the building for fitness club and Jaguar car dealer, but basically it is the commercial building. But in front of the entrance, I placed a small plaza. And from this plaza, we can see the sky. And the sky is, in my mind, one symbol of the place of emptiness. And now, today, at the end, there is Shinjuku skyscrapers. And today, at the center of the skyscrapers, there is Tokyo City Hall, designed by Kendo Tange. But it is a photo before the completion of Tokyo City Hall. And now this building is used as an internet television studio. And another, this is a concert hall. And in Yamaguchi Prefecture, west end of Japanese mainland. And I also placed at the top of this building an amphitheater-like place. Of course, we can use this. It contains 1,500 people. And beneath this roof, they placed a concert hall for, mainly used for classical music. And here, we can do anything, festival or rock and roll music. And so this is also a symbol of the emptiness. But emptiness doesn't mean, in my mind, the universal space proposed by Mies van der Rohe. I tried to design a kind of space of emptiness with some form which evokes some activity. And this is one of the missions. And this is a house for a single person. And he once wanted to be a designer, but now he is ownership of the restaurant. And he asked me for a gallery-like space. And so I designed this kind of house. And space itself, I mentioned the architecture itself, never moved. But in this case, I placed a thin water pool at the corner of the room. And it reflects sunshine. So when sun comes, and the water reflects the sunshine and to the ceiling and wall of this house. And when the water comes from this small thing, and the water moves, and the reflection, sunshine reflection also moves. And this is also commercial space, but it is built in front of the Matsumoto Castle, a very beautiful castle, and I like to make this building provide a kind of gate-like structure, because it is located in front of this, it is supposed to be a kind of gate towards the Matsumoto Castle. And but this gate is also for our mountain view. Matsumoto is a beautiful city in the mountain side, and these mountains are ranges are called Japanese Alps, and the height is approximately 3,000 meters, but very beautiful. From this photo, it's a bit difficult to recognize that this is the gate towards the mountain ranges here. And this is a small house located in Osaka, and for our family, comprises of six persons, parents and four children. And I designed all house in one space. And this space first is supposed to be used by children, but during the construction, the mother pregnant, and additional one person was born. And so this was supposed to be used three children, but four children in the situation had changed. So this space finally was used by parents. And beneath this place, the children lives. And I have many, sorry, I have many slides to show, but very quick. And this is the alumni hall for our high school located in Osaka. I graduated from. And first floor is used to be a lobby, and second here is the office of alumni administration, and at the top, hanging, floating from the ground, is for party like this. And this is a small house located in Tokyo. Sometimes. Here is the photo of something. Why? Okay, then. Strange. Strange. Okay, and I'd like to show you my recent works. And this is a temple project, and completed 2 years ago near Shinjuku Station. Shinjuku Station is one of the biggest stations in Japan, in the world. And why? It's very complicated. Why? Very strange. I like to use my USB. okay. And this is a temple, Buddhist temple, floating. It means basic area is used for ushery. And from the third floor, apart from the third floor, is used to municipal temple program. And the width of this society was very narrow, so I made passage for human being and for automobile. So finally, I selected this kind of wine glass shape. But when I first presented to the priest clients, and I explained the structure and like wine glass, but the priest says, no, it's not wine glass. It is a bird, white lotus bird blooming. And the white lotus is a symbol of the Amitabha Buddha's paradise. So that's why this building, its name become Byakurengedo in Japanese, as white lotus hall in English. Entrance and lobby. Behind this shoji screen, there run down a waterfall. And this is the staircase for guests. And this is the shape. Now you can see the right side is the human being's entrance and the left side is car entrance. And this building is surrounded by tall buildings. And most of them are hotels or offices. And you can see just between the black corners building and the tall building, you can see Kensotange's Tokyo Municipal Hall. And this is main hall. And this hall is also used as a concert hall because Amitabha Buddha loves dance and music. And when I heard this thing from the priest, I proposed to the priest, let's place a grand piano, a Bezendorfer piano here. Then he bought it and placed it. And every Saturday afternoon here, a small concert are held. This is very important slide, but disappears. Okay, something similar. And this place I named Kunuma. Ku means means sky and emptiness, vacant. And because this place, okay, lucky, I can show you the section. And this place is located at the center and the top of this whole building. And the sun comes down. So it is like, sun clock, hitoke. Sun moves from left side to the center and the right side. This photo is taken in summer, so sun hit the floor, but in this season, the sun moves on the wall. Okay, maybe the section disappears. This building was introduced in GA magazine, and so if I'd like you to find this. And this is a brand new one. We completed this year. And the client is safe. And this is a kind of cemetery and memorial park in Kyoto. And this building is located, it's almost hidden from this level. And I'd like to make this ground
continue to the top roof of this building. And this inside. And this is the entrance hall. And not yet grown well, but in the center of this court, cherry blossom, special cherry blossom is planted. This. Maybe this will complete in this spring. So next spring, and this tree will bloom very beautiful, beautiful flowers. And this is in front of the main hall, I placed a round shape of waterfall. Same detail, I used the same detail as the temple in Shiju in Tokyo. But in case of temple in Tokyo, the waterfall was flat, straight. And in this case, I designed a curved and receives sunshine and reflect the light from this waterfall introduced into the main hall. This is the main hall. And sometimes it is used for ritual, religious, or and usually it is used this kind of lounge. This is entrance, but I didn't intend to design a facade, a kind of. This is a result of the cut or perforate the window, cut for the cornice or perforate the window, which was designed according to the needs from inside. So what kind of landscape we can enjoy from inside. And so basically this building has no facade. It has facade, it has elevations, but I didn't want it to design an elevation, like elevation. And so, this is the corridor, and at the end of the corridor, you can see the golden wall, and first it was this kind of thing. And then this is also the owner is put Buddhist temple, and placed this kind of Japanese Buddhism decoration, and at the center also Amitabha. And this is a service entrance. As a result, it has very strong shape, but I didn't intend to design this, especially this kind of form. So this is a study of the planning, and from right to left, the form changing. But as you can see from this diagram, I only concerned with how to cut from the basic form, land shape, and make inner space. And this is plan. So entrance is right side, and court is in the center. And you can. So you can see. Condition of the site. Entrance is right side. The street is running right side. And there is a staircase lead you to the cemetery, memorial park. And this is seen from the top of the building of the cemetery. And this is look back from the cemetery to the building. it. So this is very beautiful landscape, and I didn't want to disturb this landscape, and I wanted to make some catapult towards the sky, and because the sky is a symbol of emptiness. Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure to be here today at UCLA at the architecture department. Thank you for the invitation to all of us. I think for me particularly, when I say the journey, it's because I believe in journeys. I think rather than the object, it's the journey that makes the object. And from Japan to Beirut is definitely because here I'm meeting with all my Japanese colleagues at Hara Laboratory. And also the occasion of being here is to celebrate Hara's 80th anniversary, and that's basically why I am here. Now to Beirut, of course, because I'm Lebanese, my name is Nadim Karam, and I have established an office that I call Atelier Hapsitus, where HAP stands for happenings and situs for situations. So it's happenings and situations, which is time and space. I'm going to take you briefly through the Japanese period because this was a very important period for me and it has influenced all my thoughts and work after. In fact, it's a period which was based on concepts of space. I spent several hours with Professor Hara, who influenced me a lot in the way of thinking about Japanese space. And I worked particularly on something that's called butai tsukuri. Butai means stage, tsukuri is style. So all temples that are done in a stage style, if you want. So here briefly to go through things, on the right side there is Izumo Taisha, which is a shrine, in fact, that doesn't exist anymore, of course. It's just a study to tell you that there used to be a bridge to be able to talk to God, to reach the unreachable, where you go from earth to heaven somehow, and which is very important in terms of reaching somewhere. So it's elevated to go upward towards God. And on the right side is just the analysis of Butai Tsukuri spaces, where you have the concentric versus the layering. So the hall is the layering and the main hall is the concentric. So where you have the stage and the, both of them together create an interesting concept of space, if you want. And this takes us to one of the smallest Butai Tsukuri temples, stage temples. It's called Nage Iredo. Nage is to throw, Ire is to put in, and Do is temple. So it's a temple thrown in. And this is there is an interesting story around this temple because I was coming with a colleague of mine, Hiro-san, who had, we left Tokyo University to come. I visited about 50 to 60 temples like this as part of my PhD. And you usually take the Shinkansen, then you take the train, and then when you reach those kinds of temples, you have to take, of course, you have to walk through, climb the mountain to reach there, so it's about an hour of climbing. And then when I reached this temple, to my surprise, almost shock, I found out that I cannot get in. So it's a temple that you can't, you just look at like you've been looking at the photo here. And that was very upsetting because we were both of us sweating hell, and we just reached there to study the temple, and it's just there, you can't reach it. You don't know how it's built. You don't know anything about it, but in fact, it's so interesting in terms of the detailing that comes into that. I have the plans. It's not secret, but I have them. And then it took me maybe half an hour of sitting to rest so that my mind shifted to a completely different way. I thought that by not being able to reach it, you are in an unreachable stage. So you are towards the unreachable. And that's where the idea of potential space came in. A space where you can build in your mind so many stories, so many specificities to the place, memories, where you can get your dreams to go far. So spaces like that that you cannot reach are also very important in our lives. Which took me to do some performances in Tokyo. This is an inspired building where you have a kind of celebration, a funeral going to reach a celebration of life. So you have the painting. And in front of the painting, I acted the work itself. So I took the painting out of its space so that we created the performance somehow. So I mean, it's this period of Japan that taught me, because I was preparing this talk, that tells me again why I'm shifting from architecture to public art. We do lots of public art in the office worldwide now. And those slides are very important for me personally to show like different acts of the performance where going from a funeral to a celebration of life, that is going to the unknown, to the unreachable, and then getting through a purification period. And then it's repainting the performance itself. And on the other hand, I worked on stage design somehow, so this is called the blind stage. It somehow, when I looked at it after, I found out that it relates a lot to Izumo-taisha, where you have all the colonnade that comes and you go up to the stage, and with some representations of how the stage could be. And I did some other performances where this is on, both of them are the family structure, my family structure. And the second one, I'm acting my presence in there besides my brothers and sisters. This is myself, brother, sister. Parents, grandparents, the dead are closed, the others are showing, so it was a very early work. And then at Sagacho exhibit space, we did the Temple of the Obelisks, in which a painting here has been burned in order to show it digitally. So it's more experiments of that sort. Now we shift a little bit to my office in Beirut, which is on the demarcation line. So this place, usually demarcation line spaces after the Civil War in Beirut were the cheapest areas that you could buy because they just were affected by the war. So to buy something like that was extremely cheap. But for me, it was the most interesting part because after the war, Muslims, Christians, and all of this mixture became quite interesting. And I thought it's the best place to buy. But in those times, you had the barricades, and you had the sandbags, and you had the snipers. And you had to go through all this process around this area. So in that sense, we thought we should study a facade that would reflect that, really, that would reflect the way you can see through to the facade, especially there is no pedestrian on that street. And this is the way we have transformed the whole thing. It means when we are inside the office, we are in an area which is kind of protected from the outside, where we can peep through to the world outside. And from that space, from this office, we do most of our work internationally. And in that sense, I have been involved recently in an exhibition where I presented Shouts and Silence, because I believe that in our region of the world, the Middle East, where we have war devastating and where there is fanatism in Islam, where you have radicalism and where there are so much crisis identity, I've created two themes with our Shouts and Silence because I think that there are millions of shouts but so little to be heard. And that's why I call this installation or those sculpture Shout, where we have the shout and the silenced, because I think with the refugees that are coming all over the world, in fact, in Lebanon, we have about 1.5 million refugees, Syrian refugees now. There is lots of silence ongoing, and people are leaving, there is even more silence. But this comes from lots of shouting for things that are not, that makes no sense somehow. And that's why I wanted to express the whole thing into optimistic kind of abstract shapes, where you have here the two shouts that are, it's called the dialogue of the deaf. It means in between those two shouts, there is an anxiety and you are trapped. There are nations that are trapped between people shouting and nobody is listening to that. And behind is the silence, where you have the sublime silence and the heavy silence. So this gives you an idea of how one person is trapped and where people can also be trapped and nations are also trapped in our region of the world. It's called the dialogue des sourds in French, where we have both silences and we have lots of shouting everywhere. Now I'm going to move into, I thought instead of showing public art, I'm going to show you three large-scale projects that we have developed in the office and that we still hope they will go, they will take us somewhere. The first of them is the Cloud of Dubai. I was assigned to be on the advisory board of design for the city of Dubai when they asked us to create something for the city. So. At that time, this says, "Bidna na'ish bi'aymi." You want to live in a cloud. So, Dubai, I mean, this project started 2007, where Dubai was really booming before the recession. And you had especially lots of private enterprise and exclusive area. And the more you would go high, the more expensive and the more exclusive it will be. So our idea was to create, when I say ours, the office, Hapsitus and myself, is to create a horizontal platform and to cancel all the floors down. And this platform, we call it the cloud. So it's a garden in the sky of Dubai. And it comes from an idea of the cloud where you had the castle and this childhood image of creating clouds, being in the cloud. And the cloud is an idea. But it's also a place where you take your things and go. But the contrast between the kind of offices private and the cloud itself, where you have high-rise buildings, there's this contrast of a fisherman that went. And here is the idea of the cloud, where you have inclined columns, because I'll show you later, it's because of rain. And you have a structure that would be the cloud and parking or whatever is after, I mean. So it's a public space, most important thing, and the horizontal platform. We did lots of studies with Arab engineers, the Advanced Geometry Unit in London, that has supported this project in order to create the inclination. But at the same time, the whole thing is divided into the fun, the sky sports, if you want, and the void, the vertical gardens. Then you have the synthetic natural transported landscapes. You have the rotating bridges. And you have the pavilion, the porous landscape. The whole thing vertically also comes in one way or another, I mean. And the impressions, the first impressions of the cloud started to come out. And then we had this idea of the inclined columns in order to show rain. And if you are on the cloud, you have, you can have overlooking Dubai in one way, when you move on those bridges that will be rotating. And you have this artificial landscape of a lake that could be up there somehow. And when you're under the cloud, you can see from the colonnade that comes up a kind of particular scenery of the height of the whole thing. And just under you have those reflective pool that comes there. And from far it will give the impression that it's raining. I mean, there is this fuzziness and haziness about a cloud with the rain. And it's about 300 meters above ground level. But then, when the project started moving further, Arab had the idea of, because the columns just leaning or inclined or a problem, they have created a cable that should hold the cloud. And this cable became the longest escalator in the world somehow. So it's just something that will hold the whole thing together. And we have probably two of them with a geometry that is kind of Islamic geometry, but when you use it three-dimensionally, it will be a fuzzy presence somehow. So if you are up there on the cloud, the trust system, what's interesting about this trust system is that you can take out from it whatever you want, like a sponge, and it still stands. It's refigured out by computer study. And here is the trying going up to the cloud, and of course the columns became much lighter in the second study. And when you're inside, you are in this fully fuzzy zone somehow. And here you have the fishermen fishing high-rise buildings from the cloud. So it's this contrast between the high-rise buildings, the kind of private and exclusive, and the public thing. And it's a rainy cloud, because rain is very important in the Gulf region. And some installation about this idea of fishing high-rise buildings. And there is a client, I mean, between brackets, client who came and said, I want to do the cloud. So we're in negotiation with him. This is after almost 10 years, which is very interesting. But lots of clients come and disappear when it comes to the cloud. I don't know why, but it's a huge project. I know somehow why. The second project I want to show you is the Elephant City. And the Elephant City comes from, you know, most of my work is about lots of elements that create stories, and those stories create moments in cities and try to make the city dream. So here I use elephant usually as one of my sculpture, and I use it as a surface where I can project ideas, where I can project stories, and the elephant is part of the savannah. We can find it in Notting Hill Gate, just opposite to the station, as a sculpture. I mean, the background has changed now over the years. This is since the year 2000 there. I did paintings using elephants, Smarties with elephants, beads with elephants. And here you have the family, the trio elephant, which is the family elephant in front of the Institut du Monde Arabe and Zaha's pavilion at the time. But the project came to the office where in Lagos, where there is a site in Lagos, which is it's called the Eco Atlantic Master Plan, and they've asked us to design a residential building with other facilities like offices and different things for black young people who are starting to make lots of money with a certain program that they gave us. So it was an interesting project, and the Eco-Atlantic area was being started to be built. The problem we had encountered is that whatever scheme, because there's nothing there, whatever scheme we created, they were just reluctant to it. So in that sense, we thought the best way to go about it is to be ourselves. And in here, we created an idea of an elephant that was searching for water and going its way through Africa to reach Lagos somehow. And this elephant will bring with him the memory of the savannah, will bring, it's like a moving city. The whole thing would move and create itself as it reaches the place itself, and probably creating a kind of a new urbanism, like a vertical urbanism somehow. And in fact, the elephant should be here. This photo is missing, but it's just 165 meter high somehow. And we placed this elephant on the canal where the site was given to us. And behind it, the landscape of the savannah. And then we thought, one interesting way would be to create fantastic landscapes that reminds of the journey that the elephant has taken. So it's an accumulation of memories that was drawn, in fact, by interns that were in the office at the time. But also there is the importance of dividing the space on the vertical urbanism way. So that's why we thought that The green part will be the savanna and whatever the elephant brought with it. And the rest of the part will be divided between the functions that were given to us. So here we have the residential area, then we have the office area, the hotel area, the savanna area, the place that is common to all of them, and the kind of cultural areas around. So we have divided the whole thing vertically along the elephant in order to create the sceneries that were brought and to fill in the functions of the elephant, which is about 100,000 meters square. So in fact, having an elephant rather than a building, or an elephant in the form of a building in the form of an elephant, which I call the elephant city, gives lots of sceneries that could be interesting to use. Like, for example, the waterfall comes around the canal because it's a typical elephant type thing. And then the elephant back ride that you can take in order to reach different places and stop and have a look at the city. And you have the big eye of the elephant, which is the Ferris wheel that could be inside. So these features become particular features of a building somehow. So we have, in this case, the four. And if you are in the trunk of the elephant watching some performances, you'll have in the background the city of Lagos. And if you're getting a ride on the elephant, then you have also different sceneries as it moves. And if you are in the Ferris wheel, of course, it connects you to different areas, but at the same time, it gives you a particular feeling. And the spaces in between the offices and the residences are what are what's created in the whole savanna area that we call savanna area. We studied also the kind of what type of facade would be most appropriate for the elephant, and the metaphor of it being part of the, so we have the elephant on this side, the metaphor of the whole thing, and in the city, how would it appear, how would it come? We tested it in different places, in fact, because the client wanted to see it in different areas. And then there is the project which I've been working on, which is called the Wheels of Chicago. In fact, we had Maggie Jar, who has done training, who's from Chicago and has done, has spent 2 years with us at the office in Beirut. And she was telling us about Chicago, and she was very interested that there is something for the city. And in fact, the Navy Piers celebrates its 100 years this year. And we thought we should create something around that event. And wheels would be the most appropriate thing. Especially, this is the area of the project, and this is where most of the art is happening in Chicago. This is the Millennium Park, in fact. And we thought, because this is a commercial area that's being restored, it would be interesting. There is a park just near it, where it would be interesting to create a cultural identity so that both of them will complement each other. But Chicago is also a city where art is very important. I mean, just taking a tour in Chicago, you'll see some of the most beautiful artworks in terms of size, relation to the city, and all of that. And one feature of Chicago is Mr. Ferris, who created the Ferris wheel in the World Fair. And that was an important feature for us because we wanted to use the Ferris wheel or the wheel as a point of departure for the project that we have done. Now, this is the Navy Pier, Pier Navy. And here there's a park, it's called the Olive Park. And what's interesting in this park is that there are big circles. And this is a park which is left derelict. If you go there, it's all broken and nobody has gone for a while. So we thought in those fountains, we can put wheels. And it would be interesting to create wheels that can be seen from the city. So they will be here, and we have the high-rise building on the shore, so it has a beautiful scenery. But wheels that would represent the different zones within Chicago. So you have the industrial zone, you have the business zone, you have the art zone, you have different zones, and this will become the wheel. So it reflects the city of Chicago somehow. So you have those different wheels, as seen from Nadim here, but you have the diversity wheels. So there are wheels that are not used, but that would represent the city. You have the leisure wheel, you have the playground wheel, you have the business wheel, and you have the art wheel. So it's kind of somewhere educational because it takes you back to where in the city these things happen, you know? You have the industry wheel, and all of them, we started on the study of a structure with Arab, but we haven't developed it further, as much as the sustainability issue, because Chicago is a windy city, so wind is a very important factor, and sun is another factor in order to create the sustainability. And lighting, of course, is important because there is, in Chicago, the third Artikis, there is a celebration twice a week to celebrate through fireworks the city, especially in summer. And here are kind of views of how it could be, taking into consideration the existing fountains in order to create this typical, particular scenery for the city. If you are also in the high-rise building, you can have a specific feeling of them. Now I'm just moving to one project that I've just installed, which is called Stretching Thoughts. And Stretching Thoughts are, of course, ideas of stretching our thoughts. So here you have in the United World College in Wales, we've installed the shepherd stretching his thoughts, and the thinker stretching his thought by a relationship to the shepherd. And I think this theme of stretching thoughts comes also with the idea of the clown somewhere. So it's, I work on these paintings. And I would like to end the whole thing with the muse, which is a project, an atelier that I'm doing under my own house. So this is the interior from seen from my house in the mountains of Lebanon. And this is the pool outside. So it's a 120 years old house that I kept as it is. But here what's interesting on this wall is these are the negatives of a project I did in Nara, where I have installed about 1,000 sculptures in the water. So I have used the negatives to create the wall, the whole wall of the landscape outside. It just keeps me remembering a project, a very dear project to me, in fact. So this is the house seen from up, and here I just purchased this land. Not recently, it was an exchange and lots of issues. But I thought it would be good to build my atelier here as an extension to the whole thing for several reasons. First, I got this land so that they don't block on us. And to build the atelier here is that so in the future, my kids will not tend, the land is becoming very expensive now, will not tend to build on it three floors. So the idea was to create this atelier, this is the house up there, and to create an inverted architecture where everything is buried and the terraces are recreated, in fact, so that the house effect stays as it is and the landscape stays as it will be, and use the whole thing with a closet, what I call closet, is niches to put sculptures in, as I do lots of sculptures and I have friends that do lots of sculptures, so there will be sculptures on this wall which is made of curtain somehow. And the plan is very simple. There will be two courts and a slit in the whole building so that it brings light inside because it's all embedded in the ground. So you will have these two kind of courts and the whole thing is open. It's one open space. It's great because there's no function related to the whole thing. You just do whatever you feel is good. And it's just that construction has started on it. Now, in fact, they are under construction while I am here, so there's, on a daily basis, I'm following up. This is the team working in the office on this project. And I would like to end this with thoughts as being an important thing, clouds. And when they rain, it's even more important because they contain creativity. And the thoughts are, and the cloud is ourselves, is how we can think. And if we have thoughts and we can propagate them and we can stretch them to have to have a training creativity, it's even more important. In fact, just to finish all of this, I would like to read to you something. In fact, there's this book, it's difficult for you to see it, but it's a book that was given to me by Kojima. We just spoke about Kojima at the beginning. And he gave it to me at the beginning of the year. I just put it on the side, I haven't read it, but recently when I knew about his death and the importance it was for me and for all of us at the lab, I just read this while coming back on the plane, because it's a long flight, so. So it's a book by Kojima and Akamatsu, his partner in the office. And there's something he was saying which I feel is very important for us now in order to continue. He says, there is something that only emerges after thinking about many problems and an endless repetition of trial and error. It could be described as the magic of space or the manifestation of fictionality. It is that something which makes one realize architecture can even do this. So architecture can even create the magic of space, and architecture can create the manifestation of fictionality. Such essence of space can only be understood when that place is actually experienced. So we want to create the magic of space through trial and error and create the manifestation of fictionality. We would like also to experience this. And I think those two things, magic of space and manifestation of fictionality, are very important for us to be able to go forward. He just has put some essential things for us to think about, and it's called Essence Behind. The whole book is called Essence Behind. Thank you very much.
We don't have much time, but there's a question.